talk about pharmacogenomics and prakritis, the opportunities for Ayurvedic industries. I'm not so sure about the Ayurvedic industries, how far they are going to get benefited from what we call it as a traditional knowledge, which has been gathered over more than 5,000 years, as you know of. What I'm going to do in the next few minutes is that to talk about some of the aspects of human variations as it relates to genomics and genetics. We also will talk about some of the applications of pharmacogenomics and its application and its relation to industries. And then maybe in the end, I'll try to give you some of the examples that may be useful in understanding and being the relationship between the pharmacogenomics and Ayurvedic industry. As it has already been expounded this morning and by several speakers and rest of the sessions in other halls, that genomics and the genetics are in fact are the factors that influence us almost every day in life. The genetic constitution of individual is in fact predisposes the individual for any given diseases or the condition, and therefore the phenotype itself manifests itself with respect to specific conditions or diseases. On the other hand, pharmacogenomics also plays a very important role, not only because of its relation to what we call the personalized drugs or individualized drug treatment as has been practiced today, but more with respect to its relationship to the genetic constitution of the individual. In other words, these days we can prescribe and provide medicine based on the genomic content or the genetic content of an individual, and then being able to prescribe the drugs, which in fact is helpful in overcoming the adverse side effects or even being able to undertake faster clinical trials, including being able to have an effective therapy. It is almost like having a tailor-made medicine or a personalized medicine wherein the individual in fact is being checked or examined for the genetic composition and then being provided appropriate therapy based upon his genomic constitutions. As we all know, there are several ways in which drugs are treated. One can take it orally, or it can through inhalation or through absorption, and it can pass through basically gut, lung and the skin. Ultimately, they land up in the liver where they get metabolized, and subsequently they get transported to various organs, target sites within the body. There are a number of parameters, which ADME, which you call them, but this is a much more elaborate list wherein a drug has to undergo various processes, and these include absorption, metabolism, transport of the drug, structure of the targets, degradation and excretion, and almost each and every one of them in fact have number of genes which are in fact are associated with that. For example, absorption itself can have approximately about 43 different type of genes in the drugs, which play a critical role in internalization of a given drug. Metabolism has more than about 3,000 of these genes and gene products which play a very critical role. And the transport is a very important aspect of how the drug is being internalized and targeted to a specific organelles within the given cells and tissue, and that is also mediated by a series of genes. The underlying message of this drug, of this slide, is in fact the whole process of ADME, or these processes which are involved in the drug metabolism and its effect, are in fact are mediated by at least about 900 to 1200 genes, which play a very critical role in manifesting the effects of a given drug at a given site. Here some of the list of genes which have been indicated, which has been extensively studied over the years to indicate that the examples of the genes which play a role, including drug target pathways, ACE genes and ADRB genes, R2AGRT, HTR, LPSC, these are in fact are not only related to specific diseases, this in fact is for a garden variety of diseases which have been indicated there, and also for the drugs transporters, ABCB1, the multi-drug resistant protein, which in fact acts as an efflux pump for a given drug to be able to export the drug out of the cell, thereby determining the drug toxicity. And these are determined primarily by the genomic content, genetic content, where the expression levels of these drugs and or in other case the enzyme activity of these drugs can play a very major role. Metabolism, as has been indicated here, intracellular metabolism as well as the metabolism in the serum are also play a key role in determining how effective can a given drug are. And there are some of the other drugs which are indicated here which play a critical role in the pathways or in the systems which in fact govern the maintenance of a homeostasis of a given drug within the given cells of the tissue, and thereby bringing out the effectiveness of a given drug. Here is some additional examples of how one can determine in fact a drug is in fact is going to be effective or not based on the genetic content or the genomic constitution of an individual. And the modern medicine basically classifies them as a poor metabolizers, a moderate metabolizers, as an extensive metabolizers, which are in fact are serially controlled by the series of drugs and the modifications, or what we call single nucleotide modifications, which in fact cover the activity of these drugs. And these in fact are responsible to be able to impart whether there is an adverse effect, whether it is a good effect, or in fact they would be a non-responder for a given drug. And these are all the principles which have already been very well established, already available in the literature. And in fact, as we speak, approximately about 43 different drugs are currently given in the clinics based on the genetic principles, based on the genetic testing, as well as based on the genetic information available for that particular individual. Here is a very simple example of how variability of a drug response would actually in fact determine the efficacy of a given drug. Here is a picture of your alimentary canal, wherein one can look into the stomach, one can look into the duodenum, or small intestine, or the large intestine, or the ileum, or the rectum, where the expression of a specific group of genes, which in fact are responsible for the transport or the internalization of the drug, pattern has been shown, whose expression levels are completely different at the different region of the drug, suggesting that the complexity or the intricacies which are associated with being able to translate the information that is available based on the genetic defects as opposed to the drug effects or its mechanisms, which determines the outcome of a drug effect of an individual. What does the current drug strategy means? You look at the clinical trials which are currently being performed, and you would have a kind of a conclusion where you will have maybe 20% are complete responders, another 30% are partial responders, and more than 50% are non-responders. Pharmacogenomics essentially hopes to overcome such a defect wherein one would undergo a genetic testing beforehand and then would undertake a kind of a clinical trial which will have a faster translation as far as its translation into the patients are concerned. For example, the Alzheimer's disease, which has as far as only about 30% of the drugs in fact are effective to be able to predict their effect. Asthma drugs, as far as about 60% of the drugs. Similarly for the diabetes, where one would never be able to predict the effectiveness of these drugs in an individual. So what happens is, in some of these diseases where the patients undergo specific tests in the clinic, determine whether the drugs are going to be effective or not, and then subsequently drugs are being given to these patients. And especially in the case of some of the cancers, tumors, where this has met with a huge success, where there is a cure rate of almost 100% which has been observed in the clinics. Well, are the genes are everything? Are the genetics is everything? The answer here precisely says no, because there is a significant cooperativity that exists between the genes and the environment, which plays a critical role. You take, for example, in the right, in the left-hand side, where there are maybe a couple of genes which are involved in what we call as polygenic disorders, have involved in the environment, but wherever you have a multigenic disorders, where you have diabetes such as cardiovascular diseases and diabetes and asthma, those diseases have number of genes which play a critical role in determining the drug effect, as well as a lifestyle which comes with respect to influence of environment, the food you eat, the air you breathe, and so on and so forth, which play a significant role in determining the drug effect. So the genes and the genetics not necessarily are the sole reasons for determining the drug effect, but also the environment factors which play a critical role. In fact, as we know of, there are approximately about 6 million genetic variations which across the whole genome. And that is what makes two individuals not exactly are different, or not exactly are same among themselves. So all these differences and variations are taken into consideration, and subsequently the drug treatments are in fact are given to these individuals. Here are some of the typical examples of what has been practiced right now as we speak, and it is shown here. We have series of anticoagulants wherein the genes can be tested before giving the patient. Anti-cancer drugs has been very well been established for the last more than about 8 to 9 years. Immunosuppressant or psychotropes, which are given for psychiatric disorders, are also being commonly being tested in the clinic before the drug is being given to these patients. Coming back to the relationship, in the next few minutes I'm going to talk about the relationship of pharmacogenomics with respect to Ayurvedic medicine or traditional medicine. There is no consensus as we speak with respect to how the humans are in fact are classified and how the drug should be given to these patients. In fact, the Charaka indicates that the man is the epitome of the universe, and within man there is so much diversity as in the world itself. That sentence itself is very complicated, and only the philosophers can think about the deep meaning which is remaining, which comes out of this sentence. But essentially it says that no two individuals are different, no two individuals are same, and that no two individuals are essentially given the same treatment. In other words, every single individual is being given different kind of treatment as it the disease is manifested and presented to the doctors or vaidyas in the traditional settings. Why is that is happening? From the modern knowledge perspective, there are a number of variations as has been indicated there. There is single nucleotide polymorphisms. There are about 2 million of them which makes individuals different. There are repetitive sequences. The human genome in fact consists of approximately 60% of the DNA which in fact consists of repetitive sequences. And these are reiteratively occur within the genome, and they comprise in a fashion that the ACGTs or the bases are occur across the genome without having a specificity to the given location or the site within the genomes. And then we have copy number variations. Copy number variations primarily indicate that the number of copies which are present of a given segment of the genome within the genetic, within the DNA are in fact are different, which can vary anywhere between 2 to as many as 10, which have a direct impact or the effect of a given drug. And then there is an epigenetic changes, what we call the DNA methylation changes, which are in fact determined to the extent of how the genes are to be expressed in terms of RNA or the proteins. In fact, the proteins are the ones which have subsequent effect on the drug effect. And then finally, the more recently, the RNA interference or miRNA, which are in fact about 10,000 of, which are about 1,000 of them, which has already been recorded and which has been indicated in the modern knowledge. I will skip that, but essentially to say that traditional medicine and the knowledge is not unique to India, which has already been there elsewhere across the globe, only in the things that we have been reading about it, but there has not been a careful study to compare the differences and the similarities which has been present, whether it is Ayurveda, whether it is Sasang, which has been seen in the Korean region, where there are four different classification has been done, or in the Yin-Yang classification, which has been done in the Chinese population. And these are all based on the physiological characteristics, traits or the phenotypes based on which these classifications are done. Well, the human dosha prakriti, which basically classifies people into three major categories and seven different subcategories, are in fact are the foundation for the Ayu genomics or the genomics which is related to Ayurveda. So one will be able to identify the signatures which are being presented in these individuals, spread across these prakritis, and then being able to predict and give appropriate treatment. And the effort which has been led to series of research programs which are currently being undertaken has given rise to the new principle as it relates to Ayurveda as personalized treatment or personalized genome. A new initiative which has been set up with the efforts of Padma Vibhushan, Dr. Valiathan, through the efforts of Principal Scientific Secretary's office in the Prime Minister's office, where a program has been set up which is called Gene Expression Variation and Genomic Profiling of Human Dosha Prakriti, that is Principles of Ayurveda, being collaborative program which is done across India, undertaking the number of laboratories including both the modern scientists as well as the traditional vaidyas whose name have been indicated there. The primary goal of is to see, to examine, to understand, to identify, is there any scientific basis for looking at Ayurveda or Prakriti distribution across the individuals, and these are supposed to be the baseline information which we generate through high throughput technologies to be able to translate and then being able to provide the personalized or pharmacogenomic principles to the individuals undergoing Ayurvedic therapy. The work plan would include looking at number of individuals across the country to identify using Vaidya's expertise as well as the software expertise, come bring them together, look at the high throughput analysis, undertake SNP analysis, gene expression analysis, epigenetic analysis, and come out with the principles to be able to tell whether there are any specific signatures which have been distributed across the prakritis. And there are also other resources which have been built around with this. So it has been said that during the conception stage, prakriti is already been determined in an individual, and these individuals in fact have the prakriti which has been fixed the time of the conception, follows the principles of epigenetic principles which is in fact is also fixed during the conception of the individual, and that is how the prakriti has been determined. Here is an example of how it is being done, where one takes the genomic constituent of an individual, goes through a series of experiments, and then hybridizes to a what we call the million DNA genome sequencing chips, and you identify the signatures within these individuals, and these signatures are in fact are translated into numbers, and these numbers are subsequently distributed to the phenotypic characteristics of the individual, and then subsequently they are being translated and then to be able to provide the prakriti based specific genomic and the genetic signatures which are present in an individual. And these signatures and in fact are now being translated and then being provided with a personalized therapy or tailor-made therapy to these individuals. Other resources have been also been generated to be able to test number of Ayurvedic preparations or even being able to test number of Ayurvedic principles on these prakriti based principles, and these cell lines in fact are being able to help us to be able to extrapolate the Ayurvedic principles and translate and bring them together with that of the prakriti principles as well as the modern knowledge which has already been acquired over the last 50 years or so. So there are some of the confirmatory results to show that these kind of principles are already being accepted and put into the practice, and there is a lot of new data and not lot of new results are being coming out in this regard. Thank you very much, and if you have any questions, I'm ready to answer. Thank you very much.